Perfect. Okay. So good morning again, everyone. So last class we spoke of self-pollination and cross-pollination and their advantages and disadvantages. Now I will not revise that particular part because I feel it is relatively easy. We'll directly start with this next topic, which speaks of why does the nature favors cross-pollination. So again, this was with respect to someone had asked a question, which is the maximum pollination, self or cross, that happens in nature, right? Do nature favors cross-pollination? There is equal chance that self-pollination can happen because it does not involve any other factor and it is like the both male and female gametes are close to each other. But then over the time, what the evolution has led us to is the separation of the gametes, like male flower being separate, female flower being separate, or some structures which are developed around the stamen or carpel. And that way they avoid the self-pollination. And again, the major reason is having lot of variety, better and healthier seeds or offspring. And that's why nature will always favor cross-pollination. So what are those factors which leads to this cross-pollination? First one is unisexuality. Unisexuality of the flowers. We have seen this particular type of flower again in the last chapter where it was speaking of either only one of the gamete is present with the flower. So it can be only male gamete, that is a staminate flower, or if it is only female gamete, then it is a carpellate flower. I hope you remember that part. And papaya was one example that we discussed as well, that papaya only female plant will produce the fruits, male plants, they will just help in pollination. Otherwise, these male plants, they have no such role in production of the fruits. So that way, obviously from one plant, the pollen grain has to be transferred to the other plant of the same species. That way it is unisexuality will always favor the cross-pollination. So that is first point. Second point is dichogamy. Right? Now dichogamy is different maturation times of the male and female gamete. That means the style stigma ovary will mature at one time and what we say the anther or the stamen will mature at some other time. So based on their maturation time, obviously the pollination at one particular time point will not be possible because the maturation times are different. And that is what is dichogamy. Now in dichogamy, there will be two situations. Either the anthers are maturing first and the stigma is maturing second, or the stigma is maturing first and the anthers are maturing second time. Second time in the sense later. So in many bisexual flowers, the anthers mature earlier than the stigma. And that is what is called as protranding. Prot, P-R-O-T, it refers to earlier or previous or usually it also refers to kind of ancient. But in this case, it means the earlier version, right? So andry refers to this androecium. So maturation, early maturation of androecium, that is male gamete, that is one condition of dichogamy. And that happens in like bindi, sweet pea or sunflower. These are common examples in which they have bisexual flowers and amongst the reproductive gametes, the male gamete, that is the anther, will mature earlier. So that is protranding. The second situation of dichogamy is in some plants, the stigma of the flower will mature earlier than the anther, and that is called as protogyny. Again, proto, that refers to earlier version or earlier times, and gyny refers to gynoecium. So it is the earlier, like maturation of the like gynoecium earlier than the anther part or the male counterpart. And this example is custard apple or even the peepal tree. So again, two common examples are given here. Okay, before I move forward, any questions here? Anyone? I hope this part is understood. Yes, Anavi.
Yes, sir, I had a question. I don't understand how dichogamy affects the pollination.
Oh, okay. So let's say anthers are maturing first. So they will release the pollen grain, but stigma is not mature. So where will it go? On the same flower, it cannot go. Even if the pollen grain falls on the stigma, which is not mature, no pollination. Pollination will happen, but fertilization will not happen, right? But on the contrary, if there is distant flower, yeah? Now, the timings of the anther maturation is not like, okay, today 12 o'clock, all the anthers will mature, right? Some will mature today, some will mature tomorrow. Similarly, stigma will mature today, tomorrow, or day after, or any other day. Like, just a like time check of this, right? So that way, if the anther and stigma, they are maturing at different time points, there will be anthers which are matured at some time point, and there will be stigma on some other flowers or some other plants which will be mature at the same time. So not on the same plant or same flower, but on the different plant. And that way they will always favor the cross-pollination. Okay?
Yes.
Okay, so those were the two conditions of dichogamy, protrangle and protogyny. And apart from dichogamy, there is another factor, unisexuality. Now, there is the third factor which affects this pollination process and which will favor more of the cross-pollination is self-sterility. Yes, Anadya?
So is it important that, so is it like compulsory that one plant has only protandry or protogyny? Or can it be like, sometimes it's like, sometimes the anther mature earlier and then sometimes the stigma?
So if it is a particular type of plant, let's say we talk of bhindi, right? Lady's finger or okra, what we call. So in this case, it will always be the anther which will mature first, then the stigma. Rarely you will find that both of them, they are maturing at the same time. And rarely you will find that stigma is maturing first in bhindi than the anthers. So they will always favor protrangle. Did that answer your question?
Yeah.
And in general also, like when we say of a particular plant, these are the processes by which one particular plant favors the cross-pollination. That means that a plant can have more than one mechanism to itself, or it can also be the case that this dichogamy is happening only in those plants and it is continued forever. Like for example, bhindi that I just said, right? It will always have anthers which will mature stigma. But in the other species, you can find some other mechanism, or in other species, you can even find that both the anther as well as stigma, they are maturing at the same time, but then their chance of self-pollination is increased rather than cross-pollination. So these are all possible permutations and combinations within the pollination process. Okay, so the third point, that is self-sterility. Now sterility usually refers to inability to produce the offspring, that is sterility. Even if we say in human, a male is sterile or a female is sterile, that means that male is either not able to produce sperm or cannot reproduce or does not have good quality of sperm. Or in case of female, if we say a female is sterile, that means either the ovules which are produced in the female, they are not of good quality, or they are not produced at all, or there are some reproductive problems, right? So that is the inability, right? And it can be temporary, it can be permanent in case of human. When we are talking of the self-sterility here, now if the stigma receives pollen from the same flower, the pollen fails to undergo further growth. So this is in connection with the fact that I had said about pollen recognition. Now, if the stigma of the same flower will recognize the pollen of the same flower, it will not allow it to grow further. So pollen fails to undergo further growth. And these are again the what we say biochemical pathways, protein-protein interaction based pathways, which will not allow the pollen to undergo the further maturation and fertilization later. So that way, certain stigma, they are well equipped to not allow the same pollen grain from the same flower to pollinate and fertilize further. They might allow just them to fall on them, onto the stigma, but will not carry further for the fertilization process. That is self-sterility. So by self, the sterility is induced, and that the example is orchids. Yes, Anavi.
So then, sir, in self-sterility, then they allow pollen grains from the same species with other flowers.
Yes.
Okay.
And okay. This is specific to the antigens which are present on their surface, or the proteins which are present on their surface. That way they can recognize what is self and what is non-self. So that way they will identify and they will not allow the further growth. Yes, someone else has also raised hand. Who is it? Yes, Adi.
So the plants with that perform self-sterility, so they only allow cross-pollination, right?
So that is what, that is one point in terms of nature, what happens, which favors the cross-pollination. So nature has already taken care of all these factors. In different plants, different flowers. So they will go on accordingly. Okay, anyone else? Any question here until these 3 points? Okay, so if there are no questions, then we'll move forward. Now, these two are another interesting phenomenon. Fourth one is called as hercogamy, which means a mechanical structural barrier which is formed in the flower. Now, what is this mechanical barrier? Now, in some flowers, pollen cannot reach the stigma of the same flower. So, why they cannot reach? Because there is a hood-like structure covering the stigma. Now, of course, if there is a hood-like structure covering the stigma, and if the pollen is falling on the stigma, it will fall more on the hood than on the stigma. It is quite obvious. And the example is this pansy flowers or iris. So I have actually a picture here, but then that will not be zoomed out. So let me just show you here. So pansy flowers, though these flowers, they are not so like, so here if you see, this white portion, if you are able to see it, let me use that technique. Someone mentioned it yesterday. I guess Ishan did it. Yeah. So, go down. Yeah. If you see this particular part, yeah, which is like a hood coming on top of the stigma, and that way the pollen grain will be stopped from falling onto that stigma. So, these particular structures, they became a part of hercogamy phenomena, where the plant has designed certain structure which will make it like a physical barrier or mechanical barrier, which will not allow the pollen grains to fall onto stigma. So that is pansy flowers. And then there is one more, which is called as iris flowers. In this case also, I guess this flower is good one. Yeah. Okay. Let me open it. So if you see here also, you can see the stigma is completely covered by this hood-like structure. I hope you are able to see this at the center of the flower. Yeah. So that way it is preventing the pollen grains to fall onto the stigma of those flower. Come back. Okay. So that is hercogamy, which is a mechanical barrier formation. And then there is heterostyly. Heterostyly, Adil, yes?
Yeah, so for the pansy flower, actually I couldn't see the anthers. Where are the anthers?
Anthers would be, let me, I go back. So, this now, pansy flowers. Open image. So these ones here, the yellow colored thing. Now the image has gotten a little blurred. I don't know. Let me check if there is another flower where you can see it clearly. No, here I doubt it will be visible though. No, I doubt so. Yeah, here you can see it a bit of these. You can see a stigma which is little greenish here, right? And this hood has been opened up. You can see this yellow thing. It's actually covering the stigma otherwise, but it has been opened up a bit. And these other ones, these are the anthers. Now again, here it looks like they are smaller than the stigma. But ideally, maybe the angle of the photo is little different, I would say. But they are present right next to each other. Here also, it is not really visible. These are blurred image. Maybe if you look at the examples on your own, you might see a better clarity. Okay, I really don't know which picture would be better to show. Maybe this one.
Sir, I got disconnected. So can you just repeat a bit of the hercogamy part?
Yeah. So hercogamy is something where the physical barrier is formed around the stigma. And then it will not allow the pollen grain to fall onto the stigma directly. Right. So that way it will stop the pollination itself. And that is what is hercogamy. And the example we are looking at is the pansy flower, where there is a hood-like structure, this white color thing. So even Adil, I don't see here also the pollen grains are visible much, but I can see it here at the center with dotted structure. So those will be the pollen grains.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so and the last point, that is heterostyly, that is the different heights. Hetero means different, and styly means the different arrangements of the the anther and the stigma. So anther and stigma will be at different height, and the example is primrose and oxalis. I will show you this, but just to give you the feel of this particular, so you can see stigma is on the top and anthers are at the bottom, or anthers are on the sides. Now, this is like a closed bud. Once it will open, the anthers will go on the side, right? And then the stigma will be at the center, and which will be at different heights. So that way, the chance of anthers falling onto the stigma of the same flower will be reduced drastically. And that is what is heterostyly. Now, let me show you. Again, I have these pictures here, but I didn't realize that I will not be able to show you here. But let me show you again by zooming it out. So prime rose plus I don't know, again this particular thing should be visible, I guess. So yes, open image. Now here what we see, I hope you are able to see this flower. You can see, again, it's little blurred, but you can see the stigma is little above and the anthers, they are little down. So this bright yellowish patches, they are the anthers, and this middle portion is the stigma. Let me find another one. Yeah, here it is more clear. You can see it. Yeah, they are at different position altogether. Yeah, and in case what happens is, usually the plant may have different mechanisms, like let's say heterostyly, that is different height of anther and stigma, and they can also have different maturation time. So that way even more favorism to the cross pollination. So that way also some of the plants have it. And the other one is oxalis flower. So this is the oxalis flower. Maybe this one. Yeah, better. Open image. Nursery live. Okay. So if you see here, again, the anthers, they are at the center, and you can see on the sides there are the stigma, right, which are at different height, right? I hope you are able to see this, though like I said, the picture here also you can see it. On the sides of the anthers there are these stigma. So that is what is heterostyly. Go back. I'm not able to click. Okay, so these were the different points which allows the nature to favor the cross-pollination process. Unisexuality, that is having a separate flower, so they have no option than cross-pollinating. Dichogamy, that is different maturation times, whether anther mature first or stigma mature first. Then the self-sterility, not allowing the self-pollen grain to mature and undergo the pollination. Hercogamy, that is having some physical barrier over the stigma or around the anther. And heterostyly, that is the different heights or different arrangement of stigma and anther. I guess Anavi has raised hand, right?
Yeah, so I just can understand that in hercogamy, then do the plants not, like, do they not pollinate at all?
No, they do pollinate. They will pollinate, but with the other flowers, they will not allow the same flower's pollen grain to fall onto it. And again, like I said, it is not always that, oh, that is the only mechanism that plant follow. It's not that one particular plant or one particular flower will always follow only one mechanism. It might coincide, hercogamy and self-sterility might be together in one particular flower. So that means there will be physical barrier, and if at all, the pollen grain falls onto that particular stigma, it will not be allowed for fertilization because the pollen grain will fail due to self-sterility. And then there is hercogamy as well. So it is possible that one particular plant, in bisexual flowers mostly, they can have more than one mechanism of favoring cross-pollination.
Okay, sir. Okay, got it.
And in unisexual flower, it is very simple. They have no option than cross-pollination. Like a male flower cannot form, cannot fertilize with the male flower. There is no homosexuality there, right? Which exists in animals. But in flowers or plants, there is no homosexuality because the gametes are not there at all. Male-male gamete cannot fuse, or female-female gamete cannot fuse. So that way. Okay, so any question, anyone else? I hope all these 5 points, they are clear. Okay, so if there are no questions, then we will move forwards with the agents of cross-pollination. Again, you might have studied this earlier, but then there are again quite a few terminologies, especially these differently labeled names to these pollinated or pollinating agents, we will see them. So there are 4 major types. There are quite several types otherwise, like apart from these 4 being mentioned here, but we will be looking at these 4 mainly. That is part of your syllabus. So insect pollinated, wind pollinated, water pollinated, and bird pollinated. Apart from these, like I said, there are quite a few. So we'll just maybe look at 1 or 2 and then we will stop. So first one is the insect pollination, that is pollination happening with the help of insect, which is also called as entomophily. Now entomophily is the phenomena, or what we called as the process, and the flowers will be called as entomophilous flowers, right? Entomon refers to insect, and the phyli or phyle refers to affinity. So insects, they have affinity towards the flowers, and that is what is entomophily phenomena or the process. And the those flowers which undergo the insect pollination, they will be called as entomophilous flowers. So these flowers, they need to have certain characteristics, and again this is more logical. This also we had seen in terms of advantages and disadvantages part of the self and cross pollination. So for insect pollination, flowers needs to be large so that there will be maximum surface area, and that way it's like, if it is a tiny flower, the insect will simply assume the flower may not have much of the nectar and so on, or even may not be much of the fragrance. So that way they need not get attracted to this. So that's why if the flowers are large enough, it's a general assumption that the flower will be more attractive. Brightly colored, again same thing. They should produce nectars, which is a food for insects. So if there is a nectar, more insects will be coming to those flowers. Then they produce scent to attract insect. Again, the fragrance play a lot of role in attracting insects. So there is a common myth, especially in India, that the champa flower night jasmine, ratrani, those flowers, though, or those flowering plants, they attract snakes. They don't attract snakes. So the cycle is, these flowers, they attract insects. Insects attract some lizards or like those species. And those species, they get attracted by the, or they attract snakes. So that is a cycle, like food chain. And that way, these plants, we say they attract snakes. So the scent or the scent and nectar or the fragrance, they attract all these insects so that more and more insects comes. So that more and more pollination can happen. Pollen grains, they are sticky or spiny to enable them to be carried by insect easily. Sticky, obviously they need to stick to the body parts of the insect so that they are little sticky. Now sticky does not literally mean that they have to have a fevicol like gum on their body. Sticky simply refers to they have certain glucose polymers or some other polymers which are little sticky in nature, and that is how they will stick to the body of the the insects. Or if they are spiny, then they get entangled between the hair on the insect, and that way if they are spiny, they are like stuck there, and whenever the insects travel to different flowers, they can be easily dropped off from there. Then the next point, stigma is sticky. Another, I'll come to you. 1 minute. Yeah. So stigma is sticky or and does not generally hang out from the flower. Now, the stigma, again, the pollen grain, they are coming with the help of insects. So, and they will be dropped over the flower. Now, if the stigma is sticky, that way it will be able to hold on to the pollen grain, because otherwise the other insects will come and they will take away the already fallen pollen. So that way the plant have already designed certain mechanism so that the pollen grains, which are self, they can stick to the stigma. And the stigma generally does not hang out from the flower. So hibiscus is one example where the stigma is hanging out of the flower. Or you might have seen many such flowers where the stigma is hanging out from the flower. And that way, in this insect pollination, stigma does not hang out of the flower, because the stigma, if it is hanging structure, insects will not be able to sit on it because it's moving structure there because of the wind and so on. So that way it is a smaller stigma present with the flower and not hanging. Yes. Now.
Yeah, sir. So, like, for insects, the pollen grains would be, like, on a scale, like, the pollen grains would be pretty, like, big for the insects. Like, they'll be able to see the pollen grains and all, right? So, like, won't they, like, not pick them up because, like, they'll be, I don't know, they might be heavy for the insects or something.
No, pollen grains are, like, very tiny. They are microscopic. Did you get that? So if they are microscopic, they won't be heavy at all. Even if it is a small mosquito, for that also this pollen grain will not be heavy. Now you know the size of the mosquito.
Yeah, so like I was thinking that they might be like, I didn't think they would be like that small. I thought they were.
Huh. And they don't really carry it. It just happens by virtue that they are sitting on different flowers. The pollen grains will stick to their bodies and they will be ultimately carried. The intention of insect is not, okay, let's carry 1 kg of pollen grain or some pollen grain from this flower to that flower, right? It just happens by virtue of it. There is no intention of the insect to carry. Okay, someone else has also raised hand. Who is it? Ananda. No. Who else is it? Arman.
Sir, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Sir, have you ever tasted nectar?
Yes.
Which plant?
So, last time I gave you an example of this flower, Canna. And I even mentioned, where is it? Where is it, that flower? Somewhere. Or maybe it's gone in the earlier chapter. Yeah, I guess it's gone. Earlier chapter. No, here it is. You are yet to cover it. This particular flower, which we call it, it has a leaf like a very long one. And that has quite a lot of nectar inside because it has a huge tube inside these bulbs. And that way, it has a lot of nectar. And also the lantana that we have very commonly around us.
That in my old school, like, most of our class boys, there was a lot of plants, like in a row of 50 meters, there was just plants. So there was one particular, I don't remember how it looked also. All the boys that like used to suck up that flower and then cut the, means like, they took up the stem like this and then they sucked out the nectar.
Yeah, so like I mentioned of lantana, you surely know this as well. And I might have shown you this earlier, lantana flowers. Yeah, very commonly seen around these ones, right? This is a bunch of flower. If you just pluck it, whole thing, and put it in your mouth, the end part of these flowers, you will find a... Sorry, Arman.
Is nectar healthy for humans or does it harm?
Is healthy as in, yeah, of course, why not? It's just some simple fruit sugar. So that way it's good. Okay, so we spoke of stigma. Then the flowers, they tend to be in cluster to make them more conspicuous. So if the flowers are individual ones, the insect may not go to those single flowers. If it is a group, then insect will have more scent, more fragrance, or more nectar. And that way the insects will be roaring around, hovering around these flowers. So that is why the flowers, they are mostly in cluster. But that is not like a mandate that all these insect pollinated flowers, they have to have in clusters or bunches. They can be in single, but most of them, they are in bunches. The examples of this is dahlia flower or sunflowers and orchid. Now, these two you surely know. And dahlia flower, let me show you that. Oof. The switching the tab is a bigger problem in shared screen. Dahlia. Yeah, so these ones, again, these are individual flowers inside this. So that way, and these are usually present in bunches. like you can see here everywhere. So that way they are always in bunches, and this helps for insects to get attracted more and more, and that way pollination happens. So that is what is entomophily or entomophilous flowers or insect pollinated flowers. Now, any question here, anyone?
Okay. So like, so there must be like a lot of pollen getting wasted over here, right? Because yes, we can't tell the insect which plant he has to go and sit on, he or she.
So that is why we, during the disadvantage part, we mentioned of this particular fact, the pollen grain, it's wasted, and there is lot of, like, it's not economical for a flower to undergo the cross-pollination, because they have to spend lot of material and energy. Okay, so that is entomophily. The next one is anemophily. Animo refers to wind, and phyli or phyle again refers to affinity. So this is wind pollinated flowers, or what is called as anemophilous flower. Now again, these flowers, they also have certain characteristics. Like example is given here as a maize, and even there are quite a few examples, common examples. Now these flowers, they are small, right? Not brightly colored, because here they don't have to attract any insect, any wind will flow any which ways, and that way they need not be brightly colored, and they are often dull green. They do not produce scent. Again, same reason, they don't have to attract the insect or any other individual. Stamen, they are long and they hang out of flower to be exposed to wind. The stamen, that is the anther and filament part, they are also hanging out of the flower, so that when the wind comes, they can be easily carried away with that wind upon the maturation. The anthers, they are relatively large and loosely attached to the filament. Again, loosely attached, so that even a slightest of wind can carry them away. Large does not literally mean that they are super large. They are large compared to the other types of pollination. And the reason being, so that the more and more pollen grains can be associated within these anthers, and so that they will be spread out easily. And more anthers, more pollen grains, so that means more chance of pollination. Pollens are again produced in large quantity. Again, you can imagine the wastage that would be happening in this case is highest, right? Because at least the insects, they sit more on the flowers, and they will sit less on the other surfaces. But wind will carry all the pollen grains to every other surface as well, along with the flower. So that way, the chances of like the pollen grain getting wasted is quite a lot. And also they need to be produced in large quantities for that matter. The pollen grains, they are light and dry. Now they are larger, but they are also, the pollen grains will be light. That means a little like lightweight and dry, so that they can be, if they are wet, they'll stick easily to the, and it will also be remove them from the filament and anther part. So that way they are light and dry, and they are also smooth, so they can be easily carried away with the wind. And the stigmas, they are feathery. Feathery because like they have like a hair-like surfaces, or a little bushy surface, so that whenever the wind is carrying certain pollen grains, they will be trapped inside this feathery stigma. And there, if at all they are self, and if they are recognized, that will undergo the fertilization further. And stigma, they hang out of the flower. So imagine a stigma which is deep inside the flower, and the wind pollination is supposed to happen. The wind may not go into the deeper layers of the flower. So on the contrary, if the stigma is hanging out, again the example is hibiscus, commonly known, there the chance of pollination due to wind is higher, so that they can easily trap the pollen grain from the air itself. The examples of these wind pollinated plants or flowers is wheat, rice, corn, rye, barley, oats, all of these are the examples of wind pollination. Again, any question here? Yes, Ananya.
Yes, yeah, so like these are mostly like grain sort of plants, so, and they're also like very high plants, right?
High, like, as in terms of height.
If you see, like I've seen, yeah, in height. So like if you see a wheat field or something, it's like the plants are kind of high, right?
Wheat and rice is hardly 3 feet.
Oh, not wheat then.
Then corn and barley.
Yeah.
These are almost 6 feet or so, 5 to 6 feet, or even more sometimes.
Yeah.
Depending on variety, but they are quite heighted.
Is there a reason for that, like relating to the anemophily?
I don't think so, because wind will be carried everywhere, right? Whether you are 2 feet or 5 feet or so. So I don't think so, any correlation there as such.
Okay.
We will just finish these two parts quickly and then we will stop, because there is not much here. Hydrophily is pollination with the help of water. And now obviously the water-based pollination can only happen in aquatic plants. So there will be flowers to these aquatic plants. Pollen grains, they are produced in large quantities because again they are carried with the water. So they have to be in large quantities. That is one of the property of these flowers undergoing hydrophilous or hydrophily as pollination. In some plants, pollen grains, they have specific gravity almost equal to that of water. Specific gravity, it is ultimately referring to the density, right? So density with some gravity component. Now, if the density of those pollen grains is almost equal to that of water, the higher chance they will remain floating on the surface of the water, right? So for example, if you see here in this diagram, the example is Vallisneria. Yeah. So that is the example of this aquatic plant, which is shown here in the diagram. So it has this male flower, male flower, which is on the same plant, and it will produce the anthers, which will be floating on the surface, where the female flower is on the other plant, and that is also on the surface. So if the flowers are on the surface, pollen grains, they are coming due to the density on the surface, there is a higher chance that female flower getting pollinated by the anthers, and that is the mechanism of the hydrophily in Vallisneria. So that is hydrophilous flower or hydrophily mechanism. Again, there are several other flowering plants. I would even assume the lotus and all those kind of or water lilies, they might undergo this water pollination as well. But that is my guess. I'm not too sure about this. But for sure, this Vallisneria, which is commonly observed plant, like now we don't have many water bodies around us that we will see this. But if at all you have, water bodies around you, especially on the river banks, you will find this plant very commonly. So that is Vallisneria, and that is the phenomena of hydrophily. Now, any quick questions here? Anyone?
So I got disconnected. I didn't understand the gravity almost equal to that of water.
So what does that mean is, you know what density is, right? So when the density of two materials or two mediums is same, they tend to be at the same position. So, and because the surface tension will act onto this pollen grain, they will be always present on the top surface of the water where the flowers are located. And that way they will pollinate. So that specific gravity is referring to this density of the pollen grains, where the effect of gravity and surface tension will allow them to stay on the top of the surface of water.
Okay.
Anything else here? Anyone?
So I have a question. So it's like you said, it says in some case male flowers such that they float on surface water, then they emit female flowers. Mm-hmm. So, sir, suppose I forgot the question.
Okay. Shall we wait or shall we go ahead? Okay, I guess we'll move forward or no, let's stop it here because it's already 57 and we will be on the edge with time. This slide we can start in the next class, and then we talk of artificial pollination and then these two examples that we'll see further. Okay, so let me stop. If anyone has